Continue.
My name is Oshu. I am the president of the Textile and Apparel Manufacturers Association. On top of this, I am a garment operator myself. I have been in the sector practically my entire life, so I know the sector in and out, if I may say so. This is what I can say about myself.
Good morning. My name is Haider Kibos Kalasa. I am Deputy Director General at Laser Industry Development Institute. I have been in the sector for the past 13 years and I have seen the growth, and we have been working as Laser Industry Development Institute to support the laser and laser products industry so that they become competitive globally. We have core areas of support, which are the first one is consultancy. The second one is the research and development, where the research and development is based on solving the challenges and the binding constraints of the sector. The third one is the education and training, where we focus ourselves not only in the lower level of education, but also in the higher education, where we collaboratively work with higher institutions like Abisawa University, Abisawa Science and Abisawa University and Abisawa Science and Technology Universities and others. And also we also focus on testing services where we have nationally accredited and internationally accredited laboratory. Whatever test is conducted in our institute is accepted all over the world. And the other is the technical services that we deliver to the industry, so that you know all services that we deliver makes the laser and laser products competitive globally. So thank you very much, and I'm happy to be part of this program, and we hope that we will have a fruitful discussion.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. My name is Prasadasi Ambao. I am the general manager for Kabir Enterprises Magamet Textile. I have been in the sector for the past 5 years, and I believe that I am a very practical person to share my experience in the sector, all the challenges, the prospects, and all. So that's why I'm here.
Thank you so much. Wonderful. In order to set the scene, especially also for our international guests, maybe it would be good if you, Abdul Gosha, and you, Haider Kibos, explain a bit more this comparative advantage of Ethiopia in the textile and the leather sector, and also where do you see the difference? So what is currently happening in the textile sector? What is the current situation in the leather sector? What are the differences between these two, from your perspective?
Thank you. As you know, Ethiopia has been said in many of the literatures or in many of the medias that Ethiopia is known in terms of the number of its population, in terms of cow, sheep, and goat. And Ethiopia was also known in terms of exporting non-value-added products like raw hides and skin. Due to the industrial development strategy of the country, and with the prospect of the laser sector that we have, not only with the number, but also the natural characteristics that it has, the government has it as a priority sector. And with this strategy, Ethiopia now is exporting high value added products, starting from fish leather and footwear, laser gloves, and laser boots. You may have heard that Ethiopia is also now, as a case, if we take as a case story, Ethiopia was not was only exporting, as I have said, non-value added products. But now, due to the development and the support given from the government, if we take the glove, for example, the laser glove, we didn't have any factory that was that has invested here and exporting laser gloves. But now we have five factories four of them are foreign direct investments and one local investment, who have integrated vertically invested in the sector. So it has grown from a significant export of non-value-added products to now we have reached 134 million USD exports. Not only in the export achievement that we have got, but also in terms of the number of employment it has created. As you know, the laser sector is set a priority, not only because of its light manufacturing techniques, low investment capital, but also it has the potential to have huge number of employment. With this understanding, the sector, now particularly the medium and larger enterprises, have had more than 25,000 employees. These achievements were not only achieved with the smooth transformation that has happened. There are lots of challenges happening to the sector. The biggest and the first one is that with the development of the value-added products, the animal husbandry has not grown as such. If the animal husbandry has not grown as it has expected to be grown, because the government has put the laser sector as a priority, thinking that the agriculture will grow so fast. So it needs a market so that it is consumed to a value-added product. But it didn't happen as it has been expected. So that this becomes one of the challenges. The other challenge is that when we plan, we had big ambitions that big foreign investors, because of not only the raw material base we have, which has reached now in 2018, 123 million heads, but also the characteristics, the fiber structures that we have, which is very quite different from the rest of the world, very unique, very soft, but also at the same time very strong, but also the younger populations that we have. We have also an experience of training a foreign company within 3 months, and the workers that we have trained have become as productive, say 0.75 or 75% as productive as Chinese. So we have a very very young force which is easily trainable. Not only because of this, that the sector has grown. There are also challenges, as I have said, not only with the agriculture, but also with the investments that have been promised. The number of investments, particularly for indirect investments, in GTP1, we have secured a few of them, but in GTP2, we didn't receive many of them. This was one of the other challenges that we had. Of course, there are foreign direct investments welcoming in the product sector as well. So we hope that this is also an opportunity that you can come here and invest, or not only invest, but also work with a joint venture or as an associating the country with the local investors that we have, because we have achieved many industries in terms of capability in terms of producing finished leather, not only finished leather, but also in terms of footwear and leather products. Thank you.
I have one specific question for leather, because this is what I always hear when I start to praise the leather industry of Ethiopia and say, oh, this is a great quality leather, great products, etc. There's finished products already happening, many of the things you mentioned. And then the questions I always get, or I get often, are about the chemicals used and the environmental standards and the sludges left and the very poisonous treatment that's supposedly happening or not happening. And I personally don't have the perfect answer to that when people ask me that. So I expect it from you.
Thank you very much for the question. I think I should first start with the misconception that only countries are polluting the environment. It's not the only industry that pollutes, but there are other industries that pollute more than the laser sector. So there are other industries, but the government is strict in making sure that the industries follow the right procedures to protect the environment. And as you know, Ethiopia has its own regulation based on drawn from the international regulation. And with this, the government is also, including us, laser industry development, working with the relevant stakeholders from the government. We support the industry so that they make sure that at least they fulfill the minimum requirements of the national standard, which is the secondary treatment. Not only this, it's not because that the government is strict in making sure that the industries fulfill the requirements of the environment protection, but also it is a tool in marketing their products. Because now, one of the global requirements from the marketing perspective is that industries need to fulfill, need to protect the environment. It's mutual benefit, not only for the public benefit, but also from the industrial perspective that if they want to grow, they need to fulfill the minimum requirements for the environment. So almost all of the industries have the minimum standard treatment plans, but also the government has a big initiative. One of the initiatives is that we have a pilot project, which is Module Laser City, where most of the tunnels, around 12-13 of the tunnels, are located. And we have studied all the business scenarios and its feasibilities as well, with the support institutions for the union. They can complement on the project later on. And with this, we have identified all the problems or the challenges that the industries, particularly those who are located in Mojo, in terms of protecting the environment. So we have designed the project, and now the project is completed in its design. We are now under the process of securing the land so that not only those who are located in Mojo and those who are not located in Mojo also can be benefited from this project. With this project, it's not only about the environment. We also want the industries to serve the communities as well. So we wanted also to have ancillaries in terms of product industries that can join in producing small, medium-sized enterprises from the communities as well. So this is one of the big initiatives that we are working on. But we will not be only focusing on this project, because this is a pilot one. If we are successful on this project, we would like to expand this project to other corridors on the basis of the raw material availability on the country. So we are also serious in terms of making sure that the industries need to protect the environment, not only from the private, from the government perspective, but also we are working with the big buyers from the globe so that they help the industries, the tunnels, to work on safe and safe working environment.